Okay, good afternoon. Thanks very much for inviting me to speak. I'm sort of painfully aware that I'm the only thing standing between you and a glass of wine, so I'll try and be quick and brief and hopefully also stir up a little bit of debate about what plagiarism is from an editor's perspective. So I'm also really grateful that I don't actually have to show slides of how to go through the technicalities of cross-check, because that's been already done very admirably. I'd like to actually try and widen the debate out a little bit more about why plagiarism is such an issue in the editing community, talk about some controversies in it, and actually I think, as Rachel said, this is a great follow-on from the earlier presentations, because I feel like COPE has a very particular role to play in this whole debate. So can I just ask before I start, how many people here are members of COPE or... No, very few. Okay. And who'd heard of COPE before this meeting? Okay. Who's used the COPE website? Okay. All right, good. All right, so the question I kind of want to look at, I have a background in publishing. I trained at the Lancet, and I moved there to launch PLOS Medicine, and I now have responsibility for medical publishing at PLOS. I became aware of COPE when I was at the Lancet. I became very interested in COPE when I moved to PLOS Medicine, because before we even published a paper, we had an absolutely horrendous case paper that landed on our desk that made us very clear to us that we were going to need advice on publication ethics. And as happens in these things, you get roped into joining, and I've sort of been with COPE ever since, and I became chair earlier this year. So I guess the things that I'd like to talk about are very much from an editor's perspective. What is plagiarism in 2012? How do we deal with some of the specific aspects of it? Where does COPE come in? I'm going to do a very rapid tour of what COPE is and what it can do. And then just to raise some challenges that I think that we're thinking about at the moment. And as you'll see, every time I give a talk about either plagiarism or publication ethics, things have moved on very substantially. And many of the things I would have been talking about if I'd been doing this talk this time last year would have been very different. And one of the great things that's really contributed to that is the technology, in no question. And I'm a great fan of technology, and I think that the tools that we have available to us have actually changed people's behaviour and how they deal with plagiarism, have changed how we think about it in a very constructive way, and that's quite interesting. But it's proving a huge challenge for editors, and that's what we're seeing at COPE at the moment. So, despite my title saying that plagiarism has many forms, actually I think it boils down to three. Now I can count, I'm going to tell you about the third one in a minute. The first one is minor plagiarism, and I just want to give you just a brief overview of what we've done at PLOS. In many ways we didn't actually take plagiarism screening, we weren't right at the front of it for a number of reasons, partly because one of the things that we struggle with at PLOS, if you're aware of PLOS, we only have 7 journals, but we receive an enormous number of submissions. So one of our journals, our biggest journal, gets 4,000 submissions a month. So anything that we want to do at PLOS, we have to be able to scale it up very quickly. And it has to also work for selective journals, and it has to work for non-selective journals. We also didn't have any screening tools incorporated into our submission system until quite recently. We use Editorial Manager, and it's now incorporated. So although we knew that we wanted to do this, and I always felt slightly embarrassed that I was at COPE and I was always telling people how great plagiarism screening was, I was very aware that we weren't doing it ourselves, we decided to hold back until we had the tools in place to do it properly, and we did an experiment, which was great. So we decided we would do an experiment across 3 of our journals, PLOS Medicine, which is highly selective, PLOS Pathogens, which is less selective and serves a very specific community, and PLOS One, which publishes across the whole of medicine and science and is much less selective. And we went into this with some nervousness, I have to say, because I really did not, with the aim of having a recommendation to pass out back, to the management. And somewhat to my relief, we didn't find an enormous number of plagiarised papers, and I'll tell you why I think that is in a minute. And this is sort of hot off the presses, essentially, that we found minor plagiarism, by which I mean in all forms, things that we would go back to the authors and say, actually, this isn't particularly acceptable. We need you to rewrite this. It's a few sentences. It's something that is not going to change the conclusions or make you want to not move the paper forward. It was around 5 to 10%, and it was remarkably consistent across the three journals. Major plagiarism, where there were substantial errors either of copying or of sometimes text simply lifted because for language issues, was less than 1%. Those are the types of things where you might consider going back to the institution for them. We actually found in the short experiment that we did, virtually no papers where we felt like we would have to go back. So that was very reassuring to us. And it's interesting to me because if you look at what publishers were doing several years ago, that absolutely was not their experience. So Cope ran a meeting in Washington a couple of years ago, and we heard talks from several publishers who were just at the very beginning of doing plagiarism screening, and they were telling horrific stories of finding 20% of papers where they were having to ask the authors to rewrite a substantial portion of the paper. You know, something between 1 and 5% of papers where they were proposing to reject and go back to institutions because of what they were finding. And I do actually wonder that it feels to me when I was preparing this talk what was going on here. It's sort of like immunisation. I feel like what we've done with plagiarism screening is we've sort of immunised the editorial community to some extent, and so that the people coming afterwards are getting some protection for it. And I do wonder that there is now an expectation on the part of authors, perhaps, that plagiarism screening is becoming more and more routine. So even if you're not necessarily doing it, you're benefiting from it. That's not to say I don't think we should be doing it, and it's not to say that there are not challenges when you do find issues of plagiarism. And I'll come back to how we try and help editors with that, because there is a large amount of ignorance on this. And what we also find at Cope very specifically is that editors often don't work with many other editors to support them. They may be published by a large publishing house, they may get relatively little support from them. And when the first thing that happens to them is they find a plagiarised article, it's very scary. And they often have nowhere to go that they really understand, and that's where Cope comes in. But before we get to that, I want to talk about a topic which is causing an enormous amount of kind of interest in the editing community at the moment, self-plagiarism. And in fact, even the phrase self-plagiarism is one that many authors object to. And there's been heated debates in only the way that editors can have heated debates on terminology around whether self-plagiarism is an accepted term or whether it even exists. And of course, if any of you have read Ben Goldacre's book, you'll know a quote that he says from the beginning, which is that whenever you have a debate about anything in medicine or medical publishing, usually Ian Chalmers has said it before several years before. So Ian Chalmers, who is one of the founders of the Cochrane Collaboration, a huge pioneer in medical publishing, indeed has written about intentional self-plagiarism. And this was a letter he wrote to The Lancet back in 2009, in response to an editorial The Lancet had written, rather unwisely as it turned out, on self-plagiarism. And Ian's point, which I thought was rather tremendous, is this, which is that I reuse words because in my repeated attempts to persuade readers and editors to take serious problems seriously, i.e. if you've come up with a good way of saying something, why rephrase it? And I think he has a point. There is a very specific point which comes up time and time again, and this was alluded to in the previous presentation, for example, in the methods section. It's absolutely the right thing to do on occasion to completely repeat your methods section word for word. And in fact, there was a debate recently on the listserv of the World Association of Medical Editors about this, which was started by Doug Altman, another sort of pioneer in medical statistics, who actually felt the need to ask a group of editors whether it was okay to repeat word for word a methods section between several different papers which were essentially going to be identical except for being reproduced in different populations. And I was sort of astonished, really, that he felt he had to ask this question. What was even more astonishing was that the answers he got back which were not consistent. So although a number of people felt like it was fine to use method sections for consistency, quite a lot of people didn't. So this is an interesting debate that's going on. I've got at least two papers in my inbox, actually, where different organisations are attempting to come up with some sort of terminology about this. And it's a great surprise to me that we seem to be getting stuck on this particular issue. And it seems to be one example of where technology actually is potentially not helping. So I guess the thing that I point I want to get across is, although detection is great, and I'm an enormous fan of cross-check, and I love the technology that goes with it, and it's a great deal better than having to rely on poor reviewers or authors to find all the problems that we had in the past, it isn't the solution, and it's throwing up some new problems that we hadn't really thought about. And where I think that COPE comes into it is that we need to do a much better job of educating, and we need to have a better debate about what plagiarism is and why, what are the issues now that we need to think about now, given that we have the technology to find it. So where does COPE come in? All right. So I think COPE has three roles. It's the education of editors, it's the support, advice and support of member editors, particularly the ones that don't necessarily have a big support network around them, and also to facilitate and lead a debate on publishing ethics. And again, this is interesting. Until very recently, we were dealing with a sort of firestorm of stuff coming at us. We're now at the point where we feel we can step back and have a more constructive debate about publishing ethics. There's lots of myths about what COPE is, so I'm going to try and dispel some of them. So first of all, we're not a regulatory body. It's run by an elected, unpaid international council. So I have a day job, which is at PLOS, and I do this as a sort of a voluntary. All the council members are voluntary. We're a charity and we're a company incorporated in the UK. But we do have an operations manager, administrator, and web manager, and they do the hard work of running the organisation. And we're funded by subscriptions from our member journals. And I think having a robust publishing base of members has been really key to our success. COPE is actually only 15 years old. It's very interesting when you go to meetings and you talk about technology, how often people say, you know, talk about the dim and distant past as though it was 100 years ago. You know, we're talking about the internet and it was, Wikipedia in one of the talks earlier today. COPE's only 15 years old. It was started by three editors who met over a cup of tea in BMA House when they discovered they were getting all these pesky problems that they didn't know how to deal with. Three editors who hugely experienced, the editor of The Lancet, Richard Horton, the editor of the BMJ, Richard Smith, and the editor of Gut, Michael Farthing. And from that time, which was basically a self-help group, I would say, it's expanded over the past 15 years to have more than 7,500 member editors. And I was interested in seeing this number compared to the number of cross-check member journals, because that obviously has a much wider group. And I'm interested as to know why the cross-check membership is much bigger than the COPE membership, because we've always thought that we're doing quite well with our membership. And we're now very much international. We have everything from the Journal of Dance Studies to the Journal of Police Negotiation. Did you know there's a Journal of Police Negotiation? Which has great problems with consent to publication. You can imagine, can't you? I mean, all these things that come up when you get a different group of journals in the room. And our key thing that we do is that we provide advice and guidance to our members. And this is Philip Steer, who was the editor of British Journal of Obstetrics and Gynecology, had a particularly horrendous problem that kind of troubled everyone for quite a long time, that the journal has somewhat unwittingly got involved in. And our job is very much to be a sort of support for editors like this. We have a number of different resources, which I won't dwell enormously on because I want to show you our website. We have invested heavily in our website. We've invested heavily in our online resources because most of the time I don't get to meet all the members. So this is what our website looks like. It's kind of hard to illustrate publication ethics in any sort of interesting way, so we've gone for the cartoon approach. If anyone has any great ideas, do let us know, but it tends to be sort of rather text heavy, unfortunately. And this is a recent screenshot. And of all the resources that we use, should I put them up here? No, I'm going to come back to them. All the resources used, the one that everybody loves, are our flowcharts. Who's used one of our flowcharts? Okay, so I have to give complete credit here to Liz Wager, who was the previous chair of COPE, who on a wet Sunday afternoon, when she had much better things she'd be preferring to do, but was actually poring over a COPE issue, decided, surely I can do better than writing this out time and time again. And she came up with the idea of flowcharts. And the flowcharts have since expanded into this enormously popular resource. We now have them in a number of different languages, which causes problems in itself, because you can imagine if you change the flowchart, you've then got to change the translation. And they cover a very wide range of issues. And here's just a sort of example of some of them. Plagiarism is one of the ones that is most highly used. Although ironically, it's one of the simplest ones. But anyway, there it is. And this is what it looks like. You're very free to, you're welcome, if you haven't gone to our website to download these to use them, we ask that you cite us, that's all. And people tell us these are an enormously useful resource. And they are written in such a way that we hope they can be useful for everyone from a student right up to somebody who's been very experienced with an editor. In fact, at PLOS, when we deal with publication ethics, I get these quoted back at me all the time, which is quite funny. So I have to go back and actually check that I'm doing the right thing according to the flowchart, because I can't say something. If I get it wrong, they'll quote the flowchart back at me. So that's one of our main things. Our second thing is that is a really enormous resource is our cases. And cases for us are a bit like legal cases. And again, these are all actual cases. They've come to us as a result of the forum, forum meetings, which happen 4 times a year. And I'll just show you briefly what those are. And they're collected on our website. They are keyworded. I was one of the people that had to keyword them at some point, so I sort of feel rather more familiar with them than I ever want to be. This is just a partial list of the plagiarism ones. They are anonymized, so the aim is that we provide advice back to editors, but we are absolutely not intending to dissect cases in public so that with specifics. And when they appear on the website, they do get updated. We think it's really important, because often what people want to know is what happened next. You know, well, you gave them the advice, did you actually follow up on it? And Linda Goff, our administrator, is sort of forensic in digging out from you what actually happened. And we hope at the end that most of these cases do end up being closed. And this is just an example of one of the plagiarism cases. I'm going to zoom through this. So we have forum meetings, because one of the things we've never managed to replicate successfully yet is how to get a lot of people into a virtual room successfully. I gave a webinar a couple of weeks ago on authorship, which with CSE, and of course it's great to be able to reach out to people, and we had more than 100 people from all around the world, but it's a very surreal experience sitting in your room at home with headphones on and trying to figure out whether or not people are actually listening to you. And it doesn't work at the moment, we feel, for feedback. Although, saying that, we are going to attempt to have a virtual forum in March in 2013, because we've got to the point now where most of our members are not actually able to come to London on a Tuesday afternoon. However, these are some of the ones that do come. You can see that we were struggling with technology at this point. Linda is the person desperately trying to get somebody on the phone. You can see. Okay, so that's what we do at COPE. That's what we still aim to be a collaborative community of editors, where we mostly aim to help each other. I just want to kind of just touch on some challenges for the future. The first one is, what about blogs, tweets, and other academic activity? This comes up in other contexts. It comes up in the context of authorship very often. And I think it's a real issue for plagiarism as well. We are increasingly seeing that people are plagiarising or attempting to plagiarise or attempting to attribute comments that are not actually in the academic literature, that will not be in the cross-check database. I think it would be good if we could see that coming and trying to do something about it, because I feel like certainly as publishing evolves, there's going to be much more of that type of interaction going on. Second one is that this issue about technology is only a diagnostic tool, it's not a solution. I think one of the things that has stopped editors thus far adopting cross-check or any other similar solutions is because they're kind of scared of the technology. They don't know what to do with the results once they find them. And people have discussed in the past, it's not simply enough to come up with a number of a cross-check. You can't just say there's 20% similarity or whatever. There's no magic number that helps you actually decide what you want to do with them. And that is one of the biggest issues that comes up time and time at our cases when they come to the forum, is what you actually do with the information once you've got it. And particularly if you're dealing with large numbers of papers, it will cost you, there's a cost associated with it, but there's, more importantly, there's a time cost for your staff. And if you don't have a consistent approach, one of the concerns that we've had is that you may end up, not to an extent making the problem worse, but you certainly will end up confusing authors if you deal inconsistently with plagiarism cases from time to time. And then, of course, everything's online. Everyone can look at what you publish, and we need an acceptance of increased scrutiny. So I'd be curious to know how many people have been a recipient of an email like this. Does anyone recognise? Okay, one person. It's a painful experience, is it not? Okay, so this is an anonymous whistleblower who is very diligent at looking at papers that are published and writes to many editors and asks them to justify a number of things, including what issues around plagiarism and also issues around figure similarity, figure manipulation. Nobody knows who this person is. They write to a lot of editors. And it has become quite an issue for many journals that it's now not okay that you publish your paper and accept that it's out there. It will be scrutinised. If it's online, it will be read, and you have to be able to respond to it. COPE is in the process of trying to help editors again think about this. And I think we're in a very interesting time, because editors used to be able to just publish their papers and perhaps not have so much responsibility for them post-publication. Now, for example, with things like with Crossmark, it's clear that the article is a living, breathing thing that will be updated post-publication, and people are going to read it. And what we're also finding with whistleblowers who bring cases to our attention, it's not cases from necessarily just from a few months ago. They're looking at cases going back, I was looking at one today, which is from 15 years ago. So there is an increasing need for us to consider what we do in regard to this kind of allegation, and to come up with some sort of way of dealing with it consistently. And of course, the other thing that I'm sort of just aware of, as the mother of two children who are absolutely digital natives, whereas I'm a sort of digital immigrant, in fact, it's probably about, most people in this room are probably digital immigrants, is that as we get, as things evolve, there's going to be a lot more blurring of lines between the scholarly literature and between the rest of the literature that's out there. And if I would like one message to come across from this, and one thing that I spend a lot of time thinking about, is that we need to start educating the next generation of researchers about how they handle content within the digital age, what plagiarism means for them, how they're going to respond to it. And so my final slide is that I kind of think we've got to start here, otherwise we're going to be in trouble in 20 years' time. Thanks very much. So I'm happy to take questions, preferably not on specific plagiarism cases.
Hi, I'm Miranda Walker again. I can play the newbie card because I was newly promoted, but I've been in this business for a while, but I did not know about COPE, and I'm terribly impressed. My organization at Informs, we created our own plagiarism policy, but it falls short on giving the editors the guidance to the process. It helps them identify what plagiarism and self-plagiarism is, but it doesn't give them that guidance, and I'm terribly impressed. My next challenge is going to be getting approval to join. But in the process, is it okay if we use your content, use your site, and would cite you, of course, but in something like our policy?
Yeah, absolutely. We're very happy for publishers to do that. It's actually very helpful because if you let us know, that's great because it allows us to have some sort of information about what people are doing with it. But please do, yes.
Okay, I'll let you know. Thank you.
There we go, 5 minutes ahead of time.